So let's call us to order at 6:37. Our first order of business is with Catherine Han, who is the director of the Sunderland Public Library, and we're going to talk about FY17 library update. Catherine, how are you? Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween. Thank you guys for meeting with us. So really what we're doing here tonight is we just want to have better communication with you guys and to...
you can come up here if you want.
Well, sure.
That'll be better for the microphones.
Does it work? Do you have to?
Yeah, we're just wanted to start a tradition of, you know, regular communication with you guys, keep you updated on what's going on at the library, and then also give you guys a chance to find out what's going on with you guys. So, you know, it's been a very good year so far, and I just have a couple of quick announcements. The first one is that one of our longtime staff, Laura Williams, who is head of adult services at Sunderland Public Library, has retired after nearly 30 years of service for the library. So congratulations to Laura, but we miss her very much. And Erin Bevel, who's been the senior librarian at the library for a long time, has been promoted to head of adult services now.
Nice.
So instead of, you know, adding another position at, you know, at a kind of a low hourly each year, we're going to combine the positions. So now Erin's working 16 hours a week as opposed to 10. The next thing is we completed our long-range plan, which I know you guys had helped me out with during the summer. And so the trustees approved that at their September meeting. And right now we're waiting on approval from the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners. It's just a, you know, provisionary approval from them to make sure there's nothing strange in there, but everything should go through soon.
Could I ask a question, Mr.
Yes,
Chair?
Please.
So the Board of Libraries, their input on the plan? Is there a framework that the plan is there a framework of goals or a framework of programs or a framework that they participate in or set out as a template? Or how are they an oversight body? Help me out.
Sure. So they are the oversight body for the state. Yep. So like the State Department, they oversee libraries.
Right.
And so in terms, they're just making sure that we meet state requirements, like we provide service to all residents of Massachusetts,
okay,
those basic things. There is no formal template, but they do want to see that we have goals in place, that we are working towards something, that we meet all laws.
Okay.
And then in order to apply for grants from them, they administer federally approved grants, we have to show that we have an action plan based on the long range plan so that they keep track of all these things.
Thanks so much. That was good.
Yeah, no problem. And speaking of grants, we also received a Library Services and Technology Act grant. It's called Customer Experience in the Digital Age. That began this month and we'll be running it through the end of September of 2017. And essentially it's a two-pronged grant. We're working to improve the level of customer service that our patrons receive, and especially using technology in order to do that. So we're providing customer service and technology training to our staff. And in turn, I'm hoping my staff will be able to offer programs to the community based around technology. And the training sessions that we're offering are going to be open to all of their local librarians. Since we're a small staff, we figured we'd share the wealth.
Nice.
Yeah, Catherine, can I ask you a question?
Yes, please.
Do you still enjoy the job?
I love the job. Of course.
Well, sometimes you never get the chance to ask you. We never ask the manager if the manager's actually doing a good, you know, day. And we can see the things happening, but are you enjoying the job? That's just as important, I think.
Yes. No, I definitely am. It's a wonderful library, and I have a great staff and a great community, so I couldn't be happier.
Excellent. Good. Thank you, Catherine.
And then the last thing I just wanted to update you guys with is that we partnered with New England Health Center to work on a couple of collaborative projects. Thanks to Sherry Patch for connecting us. I think it's going to be a great partnership. But they're going to be hosting a memory cafe in our library on November 19th. It's a Saturday at 2 p.m. and
what's
a memory cafe.
Really?
So it's for people who are suffering from memory loss and, you know, all varieties, and their families, friends, and caregivers. So it's essentially an afternoon where they can kind of forget about, you know, their problems. We'll have activities and music and snacks and stuff, and they can also connect with other people who are experiencing similar things.
Could you advertise that in the Senior Center Bulletin also?
Yes, I will.
Can you talk to Marlene?
Yes, definitely.
She talks to you, doesn't she?
Marlene and I have a great relationship too, so I'll definitely make sure she's aware of that.
Thank you, Catherine.
No problem. And then in return, since they're offering that great program for our library, the library is going to start on a monthly basis. I have a volunteer who's going to deliver books over to their facility. We'll kind of set up in their community room, So their residents can come in and browse, pick out items, check out items. We can also deliver holds if they, you know, they have something specific they want, and then take books back. So for them, those people who have a hard time getting out of their facility, we can bring the library to them and they can still enjoy that.
Nice. That's a nice touch.
And then, Beth, I just had a couple of questions from the trustees.
Hey, trustees.
Yes. So I'm here to represent the trustees. We met last Thursday, and we started working on our budget for FY18. And we'd like to work with the personnel committee to bring the library staffs up to the comparable range, comparable wages with other libraries. And so we wondered who was on the personnel committee this year and how we could contact them to start meeting.
You can just contact us right through the office, through Sherry's office.
Okay.
And then we're actually going to be scheduling a meeting soon.
Yeah, so. November 7th.
November 7th, okay. Okay, yeah, we just like to start working as soon as possible.
Okay.
Get ahead of the game. We started out early last time, and we still felt behind, so we're starting out earlier this time.
It's
great way to look at it.
It's a good idea.
So you already mentioned it, but my next question was how the library fits into the town's solar plan. We see the panels going up and everything, and you know, will it, I guess, eventually provide energy savings directly for the library?
Dave, you want to talk about the lease back and the debt schedule and the actual curve?
Yeah, we're going to actually spread it out among the town's usage overall. So I don't know how we're going to apply it. We're probably applying a percentage.
Yeah, it's 33%, I believe, to the library. They have the greatest percentage allocation based on usage.
The usage, yeah. So
that's wonderful.
So your annual usage is 73,000 kilowatt hours, and we're allocating through net meter 62,000. Of the total project, 33.9%. Of the output of the arrays. So for you, for the library, that looks like a net meter scheming of nearly 85%.
Wow.
That's good.
How that works out in municipal budgeting, this is our first year too. Yeah. So we'll have to all go easy on each other. We
got to figure it out.
That's just reality. But it is being scheduled out to cover 62,000 of last year's usage annualized of 73,000 kilowatt hours.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah, that's great.
Hope for some more sunny days.
Yes.
That's great. Sunny Sunderland day.
That's right.
And are they working already? I'm just curious.
I saw them on the app. The electrical inspector's right behind you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wonderful. he carries a very tough ohm meter, and he doesn't want to get away with anything.
I'm slowing him down a little bit. Yeah.
His voltmeter isn't connected.
But you can be assured they'll be ready for probably the first of the year by the time it starts scheduling over.
That's December was their target, sometime in December, I want to say.
That's why I said January.
Yeah, I think it has to be up by the end of December.
So. Yes, because of the timing of the project. Yeah. Yep.
Well, thank you guys very much for all of your work on that. I know it's a huge benefit to the library, but to the whole town, so thank you.
Yeah, you're very welcome. It's exciting.
It was a long slog.
Yes.
And a lot of delays from our fabulous Western Mass electric Omeco folks, but finally getting there.
You did it.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's all we have.
Yeah, that's all we had.
Did you guys have any questions for us?
No, I do like how you are engaging the community with a lot of the, I do know from Marlene about how you're working with the seniors. I think that's probably been an area that the Board of Oversight thought was a very good place for us to work with, was with the library. Because we always try to figure where the best place, and we really don't have a senior location per se in the town, in town proper. And we have the senior center in Deerfield, and it was always how do you touch base with the seniors? And I think with your Friday coffee hours and some of the programs you put on, I think there's the best place to access many of the seniors is through the library. So, and it's not just in our town, but Whately as well. So I'm glad that we've made that connection.
And they're enjoying our concerts. That's one of the funnest things to see Dr. Lane and some of the other people just really loving those concerts.
Nice.
And actually, I mean, if I love going through some of the towns like Barrie that has a true center. We don't have a true center, but you have the band shell on the mm-hmm. and you can, unfortunately we don't have that as it exists in Barrie, but maybe someday with a lot of things that were going on, maybe we can come to that also so that we can bring better. Instead of just, this is nice here, but it'd be nice a little bit better.
Like East Hampton has it right in the center.
Yeah, and not like Westfield with Stanley Park.
Oh, no.
That'd be nice.
We'll get that next. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, maybe we'll have the Murphy Park. Yeah. Murphy's got a lot of land in town, maybe. We'll have Murphy Park. But, you know, so I really think it's and a memory is another good thing. And you're really starting to span from our entire age group, from not just children or young adults, but you're going from young children to our more experienced adults. So that, I think that's good. And those are something that's always needed to be serviced. You guys are really doing a good job on it, so thank you.
Thank you.
Catherine's doing a good job.
It is recognized. Thanks. David, anything?
No, good.
Sherry?
No. Keep up the good work.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks all right, so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
All right, Peter, you're on at 6:45, so we'll do a little more business until minutes from 10:17.
That clock's dead. It's 1648, 1848 right now. So.
Oh.
Yeah.
Then we can have Peter come up. Peter,
need a battery.
Mr. Electrical Inspector.
Good evening.
Who are you yelling at now?
I just had to remind somebody at a commercial site today that they need permits to do work.
Isn't that amazing?
It's amazing.
Scott, how does that happen?
They can start, and they have to notify the town within 5 days. At day 6, they're delinquent. That's how it works.
That's how it works. And this person was going to be delinquent.
So. Yeah, right. Exactly. Statute 143 is really clear. You have to notify the municipality upon commencement of work. You're allowed that grace because of sometimes those styles of work have to commence. But you still have to take out the permit.
Sometimes we forget, though. All right, Peter, what can we do for you tonight?
I believe you have a copy of the fee schedule, and I just wanted to do a little housekeeping. And
So just question, Sherry, who sets the fees? Is that the Board of Selectmen prerogative to set mm-hmm. fees?
The town's accepted the general law that allows the Board of Selectmen to set fees.
Perfect. All right, Peter, what do you got?
Okay. I believe this is the copy Cindy gave you with...
Yep, got that one.
The original job? Oh, I'm sorry. Nope.
This is
amended.
Is the one I wanted to change a couple.
Yep.
And basically there was one for meter reconnection. It was $30, and we have a $50 minimum inspection, so I just want to change that to $50. Makes sense. The solar array for commercial doesn't give you anything, especially when we're getting bigger systems like you have down by the school or whatever.
Yeah.
So I looked at Deerfield and the Franklin County, and I looked at Hadley and different ones, and they're all over the place with cost, but I thought that Deerfield had a decent fee schedule, and it was like $100 plus $10 per thousand of project cost.
So Peter, how do you go about calling out a commercial job? Is it just by the property it's attached to, and either by zone or use?
It would be by usage, you know, whether it's commercial or residential. And I would like to say I don't want to change the fee on residential at the moment, but it's working with the sense that if I go back for re-inspections, there's a fee.
Right.
And I don't want to penalize the good contractors who, you know, do it properly, and I only have to go once or twice, and then I got some I got to go three or four times. So other towns have just like raised the whole thing, so I don't want to do that for residential at this time, unless You know, you're getting, we are getting a bunch of bad contractors. And the whole solar thing is happening that way because they can't get electricians. I mean, they, so that was a solar thing. Then there was just a couple others. The fire alarm, that didn't meet the $50 minimum, so under residential work, you got fire alarm security systems, two inspections, $100. I took garages out of there. I have no idea what that was there.
I'm sure it was. I'm sure it had history at some point. But yeah, you're right. As a standalone, going to inspect a garage, I don't know, what does it mean?
Yeah. And I'm sorry, but I just noticed on the way over here that there's another one too that doesn't make sense to me. And I'd like to take that one out of there under miscellaneous. It says smoke detectors per structure, and that's, you know, that's covered under other areas. Plus, you know, if you have a you know, they could argue a cliffside apartment would be a structure. Well, that
sure, there's 60 units in there. Yeah, exactly. Right. No, that's a good point.
I would like to take that one out.
So that can be captured in other work, Peter?
Yeah. That can be captured in other work. And I think that's pretty much it. The important one was the cap on commercial, because if they're going to build that complex down on Plum Tree, that's going to be off. So I'd like to take the cap off. And I don't see anybody else with a cap. I think we're a small town, but now we're starting to get big projects.
Why would we have that, Scott?
I'm not sure. So, Peter, you're thinking that by having the cap, you could use the second bullet under commercial work over 1,000, then there's a formula. Okay. That's actually pretty common, and it's really, it makes it very predictable. Mm-hmm. You know the scale of your project, you go, okay, it's blank as a base, blank per 1,000. Done. And the only challenge comes out of that is when they start talking about individual project costs. I just completed a project in Chelsea, and they want to know it was based on project cost.
Right.
Like, okay, I guess I understand it. They just want it actually seemed to work. I guess with that mix out there, that seemed to work. But in this case here, it really scaled to the building itself or the buildings themselves.
Right.
It seems to make a great deal of sense.
And then just because I'm running into problems with people with permits, we didn't, I don't know if this was on the permit, it showed up somewhere at some point, but to make it easier, is it just like, you know, if you work performed without a permit, the fee's doubled, and then if you go complete work and then not take out the permit, then it would be tripled. So.
Yeah, it's in real tiny writing on the bottom of the old.
Right, so it's right on the...
Yep. A little more prominent.
Electricians licensed doing work without a permit?
Only if they're knuckleheads.
There are some.
And they don't have lettered trucks, and they don't have their license on all their advertising, and it goes on and on and on and on and on.
Okay.
Well, that's not to say you don't have any other trades in similar situations.
I don't see any problem with it. I mean,
no, there's nothing here that
basically
stands out.
Just addresses a couple of the issues.
Yeah.
Well, it's good to periodically check it out too. Check out the fee structure, see how we are compared to other towns and stuff too. So,
one question, if I could. Pete, you're asking for a workers' comp cert as well as certificate of insurance?
Yeah, you're supposed to, by state law, provide the workers' comp.
We send them out. They just.
Right.
Insurance company sends them out, but I can see a one person operation who's still maybe self-insured, but I hear you. Okay.
All right. Motion?
Motion to accept the new schedule of electrical fees as presented.
A second.
Do you also want to include that we're going to eliminate the commercial cap?
I think as presented, the motion includes as presented by the
wiring inspector at this date. He's got it captured in there.
Okay.
And then just that one that you wanted to, what was that other one that you wanted to address to? The
eliminate the.
Oh, yeah, if you could just add that one.
Miscellaneous work.
Copy there. It was the smoke detectors.
Yes.
First structure to eliminate that.
And remove that one.
As amended by the electrical inspector. All right, so we have a motion made to accept the electrical fee schedule as presented by Peter Murphy as amended. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Jerry, 3-0.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Have a good evening.
Thanks.
All right, we got 3 minutes before minutes of 10:17.
Motion to accept the minutes of 10:17.
Second.
A motion made and seconded to accept the minutes of 10:17 as presented. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Couple seconds. We have a an announcement of retirement. And this is a letter being sent to George Emery, our highway superintendent. I, Robert Skubitsky, am retiring from Sunderland Highway Department on December 31st, 2016, signed by Robert Skubitsky. Motion to accept with regrets.
Second.
Well,
so moved.
Motion.
So moved. Second.
Yes.
We got them all covered.
Huh?
Exactly. We got them all covered. Kurt, throw in a third and we'll have it all covered.
All right, we have a motion made and seconded to accept Bobby's resignation, but retirement, not resignation, right, but yeah. Retirement. Bob and Eddie's skill sets are going to be missed by the town in the dedication, because when that snows, no matter what time, those two were always out there with the highway superintendent. So, motion made and seconded to accept with regrets to resignate the retirement of Bob Skubitsky. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0 with regrets, please. Sherry.
I'd ask Mr. Chair if we could get
Kurt, 7 o'clock. Now we can talk to you.
Hi.
Kurt's going to come to talk to us about the Inosky Monterey Rose LLC APR land.
As well as a gun.
Huh?
As well as a gun APR. Huh? So Rich Hubbard from Franklin Land Trust contacted us, and apparently Monterey Rose, who bought the Inosky properties, 16 acres on both sides of Hadley Road, and borders onto Russell as well, wants to put an APR, which is good. The thing is, they want the town to hold the conservation easement, not the state.
Right.
And we've done something like this before.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one request. And then since then, Rich contacted me again. Apparently, it's up in North Amherst, North Sunderland, mm-hmm. The gun property.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently there's a parcel up there that they want to put an APR as well that would like the town to retain the conservation easement on.
Really? Which how one big, was that?
Yeah, so how big is the gun property? Anyway,
I'm not sure exactly which ones those are.
Interesting.
So I didn't know what Chaul wanted from us, from the CONCOM, to promote this, or if there were concerns that Chaul might have with regard to the town. The Franklin Land Trust is still willing to monitor mm-hmm. those properties for making sure the standards are met for APR.
So, Kurt, could you briefly describe the conservation component that the town holds? Other agencies hold them in the past.
Yeah. Oftentimes the state holds it, or sometimes it can be shared. I mean, we've shared some easements with the state before.
Okay.
And so, essentially, we hold it, not the state.
So, is there any long-term liability if it turns into a tire dump one night? I mean, that is the most extreme case.
Good question.
Yeah, it's a good question.
Yeah.
I know we had a infraction of APR property years ago
mm-hmm.
in the town, but again, we didn't hold the easement on it.
Okay.
And I know they went through lots of rounds with the state on that.
Yeah.
I don't know, to tell you the truth.
I know it's been a long time. I mean, this parcel has been looked at for
a long time.
I mean, yeah. I mean, 6 hours is a sore thumb on that, in that area.
Yeah. Yeah.
On the north side.
Yeah. Both sides. Yeah. On the 47th.
On the Hinoski.
Even longer, Scott. That was that.
Working on that for years.
A long time. I think that goes back with Peter Barbera, I think.
That's that ranch right on Hadley, and then the piece right behind it, right?
Well, there's a Hinoski property, a brown ranch.
Yep.
And it's the property right behind it, and it stretches all the way to Russell.
It's got a canal
that runs on the other side of the road behind the blue house.
Got it. Okay, yeah. Yeah, that makes good sense.
It used to be John Yocalitis' house.
Yep.
Years ago.
They got one ditch that spans through that property.
That's right.
Yeah. Now that's going to run right up against Thomas's, right? Or pretty darn near it?
No, I think it actually runs up against...
I think about that because there's ag piece going on with Thomas's.
Thomas's is not too far.
No, it's...
not too far.
Blah. He works at Amherst Farmer Supply.
Jerry Bach. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Jerry Bach.
Yeah. That puts it in a framework for me. Thank you.
I'm fine with that.
So we just need a correspondence from the conservation endorsing it, and then we can move on. Is it time sensitive with respect to Rich?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Okay.
I don't
think so. If we can call up both parcels in a correspondence, we can have it on our agenda. And
yeah, we can do that.
As soon as we get it, yeah.
So could I ask one more question, Mr. Chair?
Sure.
As accepting the conservation restrictions from the town, is it the purview of the board to do that, or is that a town meeting kind of component?
Board.
Yeah. Again, because we're not accepting property, we're not declaring anything a surplus, we're just taking care of the conservation restriction. That's an administrative function.
Correct.
Okay.
It would be my opinion. I don't see
how we did it previously.
I don't know how would you bring it to town meeting, Scott?
Don't know. Yeah, they're not accepting any property.
Right.
Just a point of clarification.
All right.
Okay, no, that sounds good.
We're all set, Kurt.
You need anything from me further?
Send us a note.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. All right. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks.
No, crazy,
you go trick or treating. You got the bag.
I
got the bag.
Hey. Okay. Board of Selectmen update.
Mr. Chair, if I could, there's one more set of questions. Our, on the subject of 120 North Main, our window for questions received closes on Monday. There was a set of questions that were brought in by, I want to say, Hampshire CDC today, and those questions will get answered accordingly. And we're doing some research. We've been contacted by what appears to be new owners of the Sugarbush Meadows property, and we're looking forward to correspondence and conversation with them. Our contact was through a landscape architecture firm. So that's a very different path than we've had in the past. So let's see what they have to say.
Okay. Davey?
I don't have any updates this week. Unusual, but...
Okay. Latest update on South County EMS is that last Thursday we received a proposal from the town of Deerfield. They were going to build a structure it would have all the required office, birthing, showers, and Bay Area needed to run South County EMS, and it would be built just to the north of the present South Deerfield Fire District facility. They would rent it to South County EMS for $36,000 a year. We had discussions about that. They have to go to town. They have to go to town meeting to address a few issues. Whately also, they have to give us some more additional information also. So we still don't have a home, but Deerfield says if they're selected, they should be able to start construction of the building soon after town meeting and be constructed and ready to run by springtime.
Hmm.
They just rescheduled their town meeting, by the way. It was supposed to happen in 2 weeks. It's now going to happen either in December or January.
Hmm. So it might bump that out a little then, huh?
Might bump that out a little.
Okay. It seemed like it was only 8 years ago we heard term shovel ready.
Yeah. Well, you didn't. Well, never mind.
It's a shovel involved.
I was going to say. I'll be quiet.
That's an interesting update, Tom.
The only thing I can add is that's what was relayed at the last meeting. I have no...
You're just the messenger.
In this case, I'm just a messenger, but I do have a seat on the thing, and I'm very concerned about dates and information that's being conveyed, and just leave it at that. Hmm. There's nothing we can do about it. So, and the thing is, really, Whately's proposal, there's, you know, they need to, in my opinion, they still need to do a little bit on their side also, because, you know, it's hard to compare projects in towns, and I would say in the town of Sunderland, when we identified the senior housing as a priority, and when the land and structure became available, the town invested to purchase that. Now to try to get it built, we understood the importance of trying to make sure that the structures that were built and that it was in sync with our community. So we went ahead and through securing grants and monies and other ways, we were funding so that we have a plan. We have an RFP process that's out there right now. So we actually spent a little money to make it happen. So the only problem Deerfield's plan at $36,000 a year for a 5-year lease would end up costing us $180,000. If we went to Whately says that they'd bond the project. They think, well, there's no numbers have been attached, it would cost $400,000 to turn the facility into a usable space for South County EMS. They would want that $400,000 paid off during the first or during the lease. So if right now we're talking a 5-year lease because we don't know what's going to happen. So that means we'd have to pay $400,000 plus other things. So I'm just using rough numbers. Please understand, it's just rough numbers. So that means we'd have to somehow pick up $400,000 in 5 years, which is $80,000 plus a $20,000 of rent. Means that we'd have to pay $100,000 a year for 5 years is $500,000. Rough numbers. So Deerfield's $180,000, Whately's $500,000. It's a considerable savings to South County EMS to go with a Deerfield proposal. But I don't know if that's going to happen. So that's why we've entertained it. And you have to. I mean,
sure. Mm-hmm.
And the hardest part is that you have to take for the content. We cannot allow South County EMS to become unaffordable.
Right.
So we have to watch how money's spent. So sometimes you have to swallow hard. But the bottom line is that if you can save, you know, the difference between $500,000 and $180,000, which is $320,000 over 5 years, how do you not do it?
And the key, if I could, Mr. Chair, the key there is to determine terms. And the terms aren't necessarily the fiscal terms. Terms are also duration, flexibility of space, location. How does it still fit in with the original mission of distributing emergency services across the three towns?
It's still the same. I mean, basically, when the study was done, basically anywhere from where the present Sunderland fire station is to where the Deerfield South Deerfield fire station is, anywhere between that, the director has taken all of the runs over the last period of time, I don't know how far back he went in, and basically plotted everything and looked for a geographic center. Geographic center just happens to be the Whiteley building.
Sure.
By geographic.
Right.
But when I was riding in Whiteley, I said, let me try. So I drove from the Whiteley to the Cumberland Farms of the stop sign, the four stop sign. It was like 1.6 miles. It took me 2 minutes and 30 seconds, give or take, to drive that.
Sure.
From the South Deerfield station then to that four-way stop was approximately, I'm going to say, it's either it's either 0.6 or 0.8 miles, and it was 1 minute and 25 seconds.
Right.
So it was basically, and that was me driving a speed limit, mm-hmm. and being courteous to Blue Jays that were in the road or whatever. So it was like about a minute. It was actually like a minute difference.
Sure. Yep.
So, and that was on that day with that particular traffic mm-hmm. load, mm-hmm. blah, blah, blah. So I don't know. So it's fine. It would, both facilities would meet the criteria. Now, knowing that we're going to postpone December to January, that's very interesting, Mr. Collins.
I don't think that they have a number, a construction number, which is what's holding it up. The Finance Committee is asking questions.
Well, that makes sense.
Right.
Well,
so.
We were actually, and I can, look, we were told in no uncertain terms when the question was asked that is none of our business. And I agree. I don't care, and you have to understand, I'm not a resident of the town of Deerfield. And I understand what they're going through right now. And we are told by the members of the representatives from the town of Deerfield that it's not South County Board of Oversight's concern how the money's, how the project is funded, where it is funded. They just put forward a proposal. And I have to agree with them. I mean... We're looking for it just needs to meet our requirements. It does, I believe. It would have Zach, the director, look, and sure it does, but I guess I have to make a telephone call.
Yeah.
That's my update for today. Terry, any updates?
Just the one recommendation for award to Berkshire Design, the work for the Sunderland Riverfront Recreation Area Master Plan and cost estimates in preparation for the park grant application.
Okay. Motion?
Motion.
I'll second authorizing.
A motion made and seconded to authorize the Berkshire Design Group. Mm-hmm. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0.
And that's all I have.
Is that it? We also had a meeting last Tuesday. You want to talk about that one, Scott? Last Tuesday about the road design on North Main Street?
Yeah, if we could. I don't see the drawings that we had. It was a good working group with the Board of Selectmen, the Pathways Committee, folks, some representatives from the CPA, and other folks from CHA, as well as conservation and planning. And the project at hand we're talking about is, again, North Main Street from School Street right out here up toward just short of Claybrook. And the feedback through the public forums has been about how to incorporate really a dynamic pathway, bicycle lanes, walkways, sidewalks. Remember, that's all the stuff that's on the top, but that's the stuff that everybody sees. We're also, it's important to bear in mind, this reconstruction is slated to deal with infrastructure that's underground, the stormwater system, the wastewater system, the water system, and that's really important to bear in mind. We get lost and we talk about pavement. Although the discussion was quite a bit around pavement. What does it look like? Do you want to have North Main Street be just a little bit wider or considerably wider with an apron that allows for bicycle lanes? Do you want to have it to be just a little bit wider, including the shoulders, and then have off
5 feet off of both sides, pathways, and then from there, sidewalks. It started to get a little bit busy. I think there was a lot of really solid discussion around having one integrated pathway adjacent the road, 5 feet off the road, on the west side, with the hopes of incorporating that into the work we just approved, initial design from Berkshire Design on Riverwalk pathways. It was like 9.5 acres beginning of pathways. So the Pathways Committee was particularly motivated around incorporating this as one of the integral steps toward an active downtown, a fully accessible, what's the term you guys are using right now?
Complete streets.
I'm getting all of them mixed up now. With sidewalk on each side. Well, you know, we've got streets. We've got
lots of programs.
Yep. So Sherry's been to those. David, I think you went to Complete Streets as well. It's very, very dynamic. How do you incorporate active participation in a transportation system? We do a great job in the United States of encouraging a lot of cars and trucks, and to a lesser extent, trains, and to even a lesser extent, more regional and national planes. But as you look at their communities, in particular in Western Massachusetts, we're starting to get a little bit older. Some of us are getting a little grayer. Tom, no offense. And we're wanting to be a little more local in our mobility. And that's a great thing. So CHA took that homework back, and they're going to make sure that if we're asking for design exceptions, this is the rub, right? You're asking to participate in a state program, which means there are basic designs. So a series of exceptions can be asked for, but they have to be really specific to this one project. And we're kind of excited about that. So that was a fruitful, nearly 2 hours of active discussion from a lot of different perspectives.
It's a good discussion.
Yeah.
A lot of back and forth, a lot of things we've thought about.
And you're right, taking a holistic approach.
A holistic approach, exactly.
Not just looking at one aspect of it and, you know, slapping down, let's just widen the pavement and call it a day. You know?
Right, because traffic dampening, speed in and out of North Main is already pretty eye-opening when you saw the traffic survey.
Yeah, exactly. The speeds that are there now.
Opposed to 35, an average of 52, a high of 7. It's like, what?
Right, so you give them more running room.
Exactly,
you know?
Right.
It's like, hey.
I think what Complete Streets is trying to do is they're trying to make it so that our towns, our streets are compatible for more than one use.
Right.
So that
bicycles
can coexist with cars, and cars and pedestrians and bicycles can all.
Yep.
And we also know that the way they're designed right now, if anybody's been on South Main Street, North Main Street, North and South Silver portions of 47, some bicyclists have no fear of cars.
That's true.
Some bicyclists hate cars. Some vehicle operators hate bicycles, and some vehicle operators are afraid. And I didn't run into anybody tonight.
That's good.
But I was behind a vehicle coming down 47 today, and there was a bike, and the person was very, very, very cautious to the point that we came down in less than 20 miles an hour. But the person just didn't feel comfortable passing. So what we're trying to do with Complete Street is trying to make it so that those modes of transportation can hopefully coexist with one another. I don't know if it ever will happen totally, but I hope it makes it better. One of the problems though is that when we look at our center of town, is all of a sudden anything we're talking about, we're expanding pavement.
Right. It still looks like more pavement.
And most of us think that when you expand pavement, make it wider, it's going to make it more. It makes it easier for cars to increase their speed because their reference points change. So it's not a traffic calming device; it's a traffic
exciting device. I don't know if that's what you call it, but.
So we'll see what happens. I mean, so basically what we're doing is basically maintaining a walkway on the east side. Mm-hmm. And we're going to put a bike and pedestrians on the west side.
Yep.
It will end up with another road crossing of where bikes. But it's kind of, most of us agree that most of the bicycles will stay on the road.
Mm-hmm.
But those that may not be as comfortable, yep, if they have younger children and such, will use the other thing. And hopefully it'll align with South Main Street, which where the trolley was on the west side back in the day when Tom Zimnoski was in diapers. Right, Tommy?
I remember those days well.
Could I add
something?
Sure.
Absolutely.
Conversation. Sure. Traveling South Main Street all the time, the best speed bump that you have going on there to slow traffic down, Millstone Farm, Millstone Market.
Huh.
Think about it. When you're coming down and you see cars lining
up, it's
true,
actually.
You're slowing down.
Yeah.
You know somebody's going to either back out or pull in or something like this, so you automatically, as for me, I automatically start slowing down.
You do, because you're
you notice the other cars. Everyone, you see a big truck there, you start slowing down.
You put a black and white Sunderland Cruiser out there, they slow down too.
That's true.
This is true. And then they catch the neighbors that are speeding by.
Yeah. All right. So that actually very, I thought it was a very productive meeting. We're very lucky to, in our town, to have people on the Pathways Committee and the Planning Board, mm-hmm, that are very involved and are willing to share their time, mm-hmm, and their expertise coming up with plans and discussing plans. And again, it's the part of discussion. You can't,
right,
be afraid to have discussion.
Right.
The plan has changed from the original. Mm-hmm. The original proposal was much different. We had a much larger layout.
Yep.
So things are changing, but we'll make it. We'll make do. So thank you, Scott.
You're welcome.
Chief?
Okay. How'd you do?
Scott, we have on here the next, so we're done with Sherry, you're all set, right?
I'm all set. Mm-hmm.
We're going to save the guy behind the controls for a couple seconds. We have a appointment of selectman representative for police union negotiations. Scott, you haven't even freed up you haven't been relieved of that duty for very long, have you, Scott?
It seems like it was only 20 months ago, Mr. Chair.
Or so.
That's right. Sherry,
you want to continue?
Sherry had reached out and said, we were given formal notification in the framework of the contract in writing from the association to open negotiations. It's right in time. It's just the right timing.
Excellent.
And I was notified. Sherry notified me, and I said it would be important to put it on the board's meeting as we go about this through the appointing process as a representative of the board.
I nominate Scott Bergeron.
Second.
See how quick that was, Sherry?
why are you prolonging this, Scott?
That's all right.
Just get it over.
All right.
Come on, Scott. All those in favor of Scott Bergeron, you may vote for yourself, Scott.
Thanks.
Please signify by saying aye.
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 Right. And it's greatly appreciated, the experience and the knowledge that.
I would trade you one night on the South County EMS.
Yeah.
I'm sure you probably wouldn't want to do.
No, probably not so much.
Actually, maybe we should rotate that, just to keep it fresh.
I would agree.
Yeah.
Fresh. Well, the nice part about our meetings is they're usually about 7:30 in the morning.
Ah,
so we've been doing them in the last two rounds.
Really,
7:30 a.m.
Good.
Interestingly all enough, right, though, we all bring our own coffee. Anyway.
I have a pot downstairs.
Town administrator, please notify the union that Selectman Bergeron is going to once again
don the
Wizard of Oz hat.
Alrighty.
All right. What else we got to talk about tonight?
FCAT thing.
You gonna come up here? You gonna come up here, there, Mister?
He's the vice president of the board.
Nice.
He's gonna be your.
You just spend 15 minutes picking on him.
I hold all grudges.
Yeah, but we hold the lease.
I took off my WMUA sweatshirt because I'm going to hide that because I don't want to see.
Don't want any conflicts.
You just had the chair of the Conservation Commission walk up with a fox jacket.
You saw that on the back.
I mean, free coat's a free coat. I get
whatever,
it.
Whatever, you know. I'm just here to take and answer questions, but also to support Mr. Collins.
Support?
Well, yeah.
First time I knew Mr. Collins needed support.
Well, hey, you know, times have changed.
All right, Sherry, where are we going to go?
We received one proposal, and that was from FCAT. I believe the board has had a chance to review them and score them. And reached an agreement on the rating of advantageous. And town council is working on a draft lease agreement that we can incorporate the terms and negotiate a few as well. I don't have it yet, but I did reach out to Sharon.
What are we looking for the length of the first lease?
Well, Chris, we were saying
3 years.
3 years, yeah.
So we're going to make them pay the lease all up front? In case they try to scoot out on us?
I got 10 bucks
after that. After construction, that's $3 American based on the RFP.
No payments will be accepted in British pounds either right now.
Mr. Chair, if I could, in a serious note, the only area that I had written down under the evaluation sheet was ability to maintain premise.
And
I think under category 3, ability to maintain premise, you know, maintenance, we pay for, as a leasers, we would pay for maintenance. And I hear about maintenance, I think about heat, water, lighting, etc. As we go about the process of developing the lease, I assume that maintenance component of the leaser is going to be under the function of housekeeping.
Yeah, I think, contrary to our last RFP that we did with the Board of Oversight, I think that once we accept this, now we can sit down and we can discuss lease and all that good stuff.
Right, right.
And I would not expect the person leasing the premises to pay if we start spring a leak over there.
No, I understand. It was just
if the windows start rattling. Right. Unless if they
totally
again, they should be responsible if they're filming a cooking show and the chef throws a spatula through the window.
You never know.
You should be responsible for fixing whatever.
That's what insurance
grease
is for.
Fire.
Exactly. That was the only area that had some measure of ambiguity in its definition. Everything else I had scheduled, I had scored as advantageous.
Agreed 100%.
Right.
I think, what do you want us to, do we have to, do you want to accept their proposal?
Yeah, a motion to accept the
contingent upon upon negotiations of satisfactory conclusion of lease.
Sounds good.
Is that okay?
Yep.
So moved.
Okay, we have a motion made.
Second.
To accept the FCAT proposal. Mm-hmm. Subject to lease negotiations to start as soon as we can come up to the, and they're going to do all the renovations and that kind of stuff. So that talks itself also. And again, why we say this is because they're saying that we have to consider. We have to consider security of the building. We have to consider, you know, who's paying for the lights, who has to pay for the heat in.
There is some displacement of department heads.
Yeah, and then we have to take care of that. Plus, you know, insurance. You know, they're going to carry insurance. What area they have to be cover their insurance for their equipment. Then we have to have, you know, our insurance for the building. So we have to work all of that out. But the acceptance of this allows us to do that. Right?
Right.
Okay. So if all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We have a 3-0 acceptance of FCAT's proposal. Very good.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
All right, how's that?
Good. Thank you. We were going to have a 300th beard growing competition, but we decided to axe that because Scott would probably win. So first and second and third place, so it'd be give us surprise money now.
So like Tom mentioned the 300, just so if there's anybody out there that's not out trick-or-treating, the Sunderland 300 committee is holding a leaf collection.
Leaf and garden composting collection.
Nice.
And it's going on Saturdays from 11 to 4. The container is located behind the highway garage.
Nice.
And that we have representatives from the 300th committee manning that container. And we're just asking for donations. So when you bring your stuff, a couple of bucks.
Leaves, compostables, no leaves.
We have leaves, yeah. We have garden waste, compostables, stuff, but also a small brush, less than an inch in diameter. And all of the composting in the container is being provided by Martin's Farm of Greenfield.
Nice.
For free.
Nice.
And that they've already came to pick up the one container. It was about a third full. Huh? And so we're working on the second container at this point here. But pretty much we have information regarding how to compost, but also do's and don'ts, but also a nice little thank you note from the 300th anniversary committee saying where the money's going to go and what we're planning on doing and stuff like that there. So pretty much we come, we help take out stuff and throw it in the composting, into the composting bin. And also George has said that if we get big piles of stuff, he'll take in volunteer services to take and pick the stuff up with the
get them loaded in the loader
and that stuff and dump it in and do us a little compost. But anyways, so far so good. The weather's been cooperating, and I must say that highly technology that I have is limited to my old cell phone here. And not this past Saturday, the Saturday before last.
Flip?
I know, it's a flip phone. How's this? But it has a camera on it.
Nice.
How to operate it, I have no idea. As I'm waiting in the shower of one of the fall storms or whatever, I'm sitting there, it's raining, and I'm thinking, and I'm looking out my rearview mirror, I said, what the? So I turn around and look.
Big rainbow.
The big rainbow.
Nice.
Oh my
nice.
God. You turn around, and how this happened, I don't know. It went from Sugarloaf over to the mountains there, and it was a low horizon rainbow, so it just came right over the town, I thought.
There you go. Figures the gold pots are on either side of it.
But anyways, I got it on here someplace. I don't know how to get it off.
David will work with you on that.
But it was like, so good, maybe not worthwhile. But anyways, it is going well. And we're looking, the people that have been coming have been very appreciative of the service. And they've been bringing stuff in. And pretty much that's all we're asking for at this point.
I just was saying that one of the things that we've heard for a while is about having something for people to...
Right.
Maybe if this works, maybe we continue to do a spring. When we do spring cleanup, we can do the same thing.
Exactly.
Once or twice a year,
it's a good way to we're doing two things. You're getting rid of the yard waste, plus you're helping out the 300. So,
and we're getting the word out for that. And actually, the word has been spreading, and I was. Just got a couple of calls from town people that they have taken and they have stepped forward and said that I want to take and do this.
Nice.
I want to take and be involved. Write their name down, make the contact information, and bingo, bango, and that stuff. I'm pegging them right in.
Nice.
So they're seeing stuff. We're keeping it community central. 300 years of building community. That's our logo.
Well. I think it was interesting. Palmer just had their 300.
Right.
And I think it was interesting, the turnout.
Right. So. Exactly. And we're keeping that in mind, too. I brought that to our last meeting. So pretty much it's focus, community, celebration, and, I think we've got a lot of people stepping forward and coming up with ideas, but not big ideas.
Right.
It's small town community stuff that we can take and work with, and then to take and plug in to take and make a nice celebration.
And it'll happen over the years. Well, not everything in 1 week,
right.
So it's not going to kill any one person.
Right. No. And that's the other aspect is the fact that going along, starting up this early, that we can hit a couple of fiscal years, mm-hmm. and also a couple of years of also other people donating, you know, financially and or whatever. So we're working on that. So one step at a time.
Thank
so
you. Far, so
good. Okay,
nice
okay.
Job. Next time.
Thanks.
All righty, guys. Thank you.
Anything else, Mr. Bergeron?
Nope, that's all.
Mr. Pierce?
Just stay safe out there. It's Halloween.
Sherry?
I'm good.
Mr. Collins, you want any more bombshells back there?
Not that I know.
What's the emails on that server?
All right. Without hearing any, today is Halloween, October 31st. It is now 7:37. I hope everyone is having a wonderful evening. One of the things that would happen a little different this year is we actually had the chief of police actually kind of designated some hours. I thought that was kind of good. I think everybody always kind of, when do we trick or treat?
Sure. That was good, and we got to see members of the police department of the community as I was coming into this meeting on South Main Street in high-vis vests and surrounded by ghosts and goblins.
And whatnot, yep.
So, while we can't be in Salem tonight, we are in Sunderland. So.
There you go.
So, without hearing anything more, a final...
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
A motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye.